that mean, right? You're out and you're talking, you're praying over a blind man and he can see, and you're praying over a deaf man and he can hear, and there's this woman that's never walked before, and you pray over her, and she gets up and walks. Would you be a little bit excited about that? Let's be honest. I mean, these guys are jacked up, right? So check this out, y'all. These guys are so, they come back together in Luke chapter number 10, and they're like, they're all comparing stories. You know how guys are always comparing fishtails, right? I mean, they're like, yeah, but I was like, there was these three demonic guys, man. Oh, yeah, but I had four demonic guys, and there's something, you know, they're all telling these stories, and then and they say to Jesus, Jesus, even the demons are subject to us. And this is what Jesus says. He says, if you really want something to rejoice about, don't rejoice that the demons are subject unto you. Don't rejoice that you can heal people and they can see or hear or walk. But if you want something really to rejoice in, this is what he said, rejoice that your names are written in heaven. In other words, don't just rejoice about what you do for God. You rejoice over what God has done for you. He saved you. You've become a child of God. That's who you are. And nothing can ever change that. No one can ever take that away. You can't even mess that up yourself. You would if you could. But you can't, because God won't let you, because it's all of his grace. We rejoice because we're children of God. Let's pray together today. Father, thank you so much that our names are written in heaven, the Bible says. That our names are written in the book of life, Lord God. And I pray, Lord, that for every man and woman here this morning, Lord, that would be our rejoicing today. Not about what we do for you. It's all about what you've done for us, Jesus Christ. You left heaven. You lived a sinless life, and you died on the cross so that we could be saved. And I pray today, Lord, that we would just give you honor and give you glory. God, that we would worship you, Jesus Christ. That we would honor you and praise you today, Lord Jesus. Thank you. And I pray this morning, Lord, you speak to our hearts today. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would just grow us and challenge us. I pray, Lord, you convict us and strengthen us today. I pray right now with our heads bowed and ask, God, speak to my heart today. God, challenge me today. God, help me today to become who you want me to be. Well, thank you, Lord, for it all. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. How are you doing today? Amen. Thanks for coming out this morning on this week after Easter with snow. You know what I really enjoyed about the snow today? It, like right here anyways, it like snowed on the grass, but not on the walkways. I didn't snow, but it didn't, you know, so I told God, I said, God, you can make it snow like this every time in the winter if you want. No snow on the parking lot. Think of how much money we'd save in plowing. It would be just like snow. But it was pretty cool. But it was crazy, the weather though, right? I mean, it was like 70 degrees the other day, and then it was hailing, and then it was snow. I mean, it was kind of like Exodus, you know? So I was waiting to see what else would happen, like after the hail, that maybe lice would come or something like that, or plagues and frogs. I was going to blame it on Kyle Hines. That's what I was going to do, man. I was all ready to throw him under the bus. We are glad that you're here this morning. So this is really, really embarrassing. I got to be honest with you. Somewhere between last service and this service, I lost my Bible. So it's here, but I'm going to have to read it off of this. Even for technology. So we're going to start in Genesis, so you're going to have to bear with me here. I'm totally not used to preaching out of home. Genesis chapter 37, and that would mess me up even more, man. Yeah, thank you. Genesis chapter 37, I'm really jacked. We're actually starting a sermon series today, really just building off of what we talked about last week at Easter time, that God meets us where we are. But I also wanted to take a moment and thank everyone. We had a number of people at every service this morning that the first time here was last Sunday at Easter. And actually, we had another couple that was just here at our last service. They said, we saw your Easter signs everywhere, but we couldn't come last week, so we came this week. How awesome is that, right? So and we had a limo for everybody that served and prayed and gave and did music and greeted people and all of that stuff. We had a little over 1,100 people that worshiped with us last weekend. And better than that, listen, better than that, we had over 40 people that invited Jesus Christ to be the first. New beginnings and excited. I'm really, really excited about this sermon series that we're kicking off today. And to be honest with you, I'm not sure how many weeks this is going to be. It's a good portion of the book of Genesis, so it could be 4 weeks, which I had originally planned. But sometimes my sermons turn into mega sermons, and so then I have to divide them up, right? And so now I have seven sermons that I'm ready to preach on the life of Joseph. He's just an average Joe. That's what I love about the Bible. The Bible is not about all of these, you know, supernatural people, these dynamic heroes of the faith who had some kind of, you know, amazing divinity about them that caused them to do great things for God. That's not the Bible at all. As a matter of fact, if that was the Bible, I think, would be very discouraging. If it was the story of all of these superheroes of Christianity and superheroes of faith who had so much more faith than everybody else that we could have, I would feel ostracized by the Bible, to be honest with you. But the Bible is just the opposite of that. The Bible is a book about very average, ordinary people, just people that don't have always great faith, people that stumble, people that struggle, people that do good and bad things happen to them. Have you ever been there? I mean, that's the story of the Bible. It's the story of ordinary people who find an extraordinary God. That's the story of the Bible. And that's the story God wants in your life. He wants to take ordinary people. Can I ask you this? Are you normal? Are you normal? What does that even mean, right? I'm normal. Hey, if you think you're normal, you're probably not. I'm just saying, okay? I mean, what does normal even mean today? You know, because all of us, to me, normal means you're crazy and there's a lot of dysfunction. And some days you feel really, really good and some days you feel really, really bad. Sometimes you do really nice, good, godly things, and other times you just do stupid, foolish, ungodly things. That's when you read the Bible, that's pretty much normal, to be honest with you. It's because it really is a book that doesn't point to people, it's a book that points to God. And so we're going to read the story of this life of this guy named Joseph. And there's a verse that I want you to see. Actually, hold on to Genesis 37, that's what we're going to start in a moment. But I want you to see one verse before that. I want you to claim this verse for this entire sermon series. It's found in the Old Testament in the book of 2 Chronicles, chapter number 16, verse number 9. 2 Chronicles 16:9. I memorized this verse a long, long time ago in the King James Bible. And it is a tremendous promise. And it really is, I think, this verse. It really does tell the story of what God wants to do in and through the Word, through your life. This is what it says. 2 Chronicles, right? In there yet? 1 Samuel, 1 Kings, 2 Chronicles, right? Chapter 16, verse number 9, right? If you haven't memorized the books of the Bible, you should do that because we're having a test on that next time. But you should do that anyways, though. 2 Chronicles 16:9. Check this verse out. This is what it says. And I want to put this in the context, again, of God using ordinary people. It says this, "For the eyes of the Lord," this is the King James Bible, "for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth, seeking to show himself strong on behalf of those whose hearts are perfect toward God." Let me tell you, just break that down a little bit. God looks through the whole earth, literally. God, the God of heaven, he's looking through the whole earth today, 7 billion people. And God is looking right now to find one person today here in this room, right now. The eyes of the Lord look to and fro. And he's looking for that one person who will give him their heart and say, "Jesus, I'll trust you. With all of my life, with all of my family, with all of my decisions, with all of my job, with all of my money, with everything I have, I'm just going to trust you. That's all I can do." God is looking for one person that will trust him so that God can show himself strong in and through their life. That's the story that we're about to read. That's the story of a young man, Joseph. And God, he devotes a lot of time to it, to be honest with you. Genesis chapter number 37, all the way through Genesis chapter number 50, there's actually one chapter in there that doesn't read about Joseph, but every other chapter, there's 14 chapters of the Bible. Check this out. 14 chapters of the book of Genesis recount the life of this one guy named Joseph. As a matter of fact, it's the same amount of time that God spends on the life of Abraham, and he's pretty important to the story. By volume, there's more verses written about the life of Joseph than there are about the life of Abraham. So what I'm suggesting is that when God stops things in his book, and he says, hey, we're just not going to run by this guy, we're going to spend some time looking at his life, that you and I ought to focus in on that. That when God slows it down, because sometimes, you know, we can kind of read through the Bible, and we just kind of read, it's like a sitcom sometimes, you know, it's like a television show. You can read Joseph's life, it's 14 chapters. For most of you, that would probably take you about an hour, a little more, a little less, or something. That you could just read those chapters of the Old Testament, and you see all the good and all the bad and all the struggle and the happily ever after at the end, and you think, wow, that was easy for Joseph. But it wasn't 1 hour for him. As a matter of fact, when the story starts in Genesis 37, Joseph is 17 years old. After spending more than 10 years in prison and a decade as a slave on top of that, when you get to the end of Genesis chapter number 50, Joseph is 41 years old. Before there's resolution, before things are made right, there's over two decades of his life that go by. As a matter of fact, the time from 17 years old or 18 years old until Joseph is 28 years old, those are important years of your life, don't you think, guys? I mean, right in the middle of there, I mean, that's kind of prime time, isn't it? 17 until 28, he spends it in prison for something he didn't even do. And after that, I mean, he becomes a slave even longer, and when he's told he's going to be promoted, he's not. He's forgotten. Sometimes, again, you know, we watch TV and we see, you know, like those sitcoms. They, you know, every time you watch a sitcom, right, it's 30 minutes long, but they're not even really 30 minutes because it's commercial time. And so they're like 23 minutes. And then within the first 5 minutes, there's this big problem that happens, right? And then by the 27th minute, it's all good. You know what I'm talking about? And that's the way we think that life should be sometimes. And all of those sitcoms, it seems like it works out for everybody, except for Gilligan. Like Gilligan, he never gets off the island, right? I mean, man. And you wonder how everybody didn't hate him, because it was always his fault. It's like every single week, man, they had a chance to get off the island, and he blows it. And I guess, though, eventually, I heard this letter that he does get off the island. Is that right? Eventually, there's some Gilligan special 10 years later. The Gilligan anniversary where he gets off the island, and then I heard that he actually lands back on the island. But, you know, the Bible's more than a sitcom. And it's more than just a novel. It's life. This is life. And the beauty of it is, what I love about the Bible is it's not pie in the sky. It's not just rainbows and unicorns. It's not just rose-colored glasses. It's all the good and all the bad and all the ugly. Joseph, you know, we see all the lessons, and I'm excited because of some of the lessons that we're going to cover in the next few weeks together. I mean, talking about family and friends and knowing your friends and how to be a friend and who to avoid as a friend and issues of trust and stewardship and how do I handle a hostile work environment. You realize that's in the Bible and it's in the story of Joseph. What do I do when I'm forgotten? What do I do when I'm waiting? Have you ever had to wait for God to do something? Man, there's a whole bunch about waiting. What do I do when I'm waiting that's in this story? There's a bunch about God's plan and forgiveness and revenge. He's not some Superman. He's just really an average Joe with a very, very humble beginning. So if you have your Bibles, let's get right to it now. Genesis chapter 37. We'll get into it here. Genesis 37, verse number 1. It says, and Jacob, you know what, I'm going to do this. I'm stopping. Time out right here. You can just talk among yourselves. I'm changing versions. There we go. All right. It says this. So Jacob settled again in the land of Canaan, where his father had lived as a foreigner. This is the account of Jacob and his family. So this is the story of a family. And then it says this in verse number 2. When Joseph, this is the guy we're going to focus on. When Joseph was 17 years old, he often tended his father's flock. He worked for his half-brothers. Yeah, how did that go? And the sons of his father's wives, Bilhah and Zilpah. But Joseph reported to his father some of the bad things his brothers were doing. He worked for them and he told on them every time they did something wrong. Yeah, that's a good idea, right? And so it says Jacob, now check this verse out. So Jacob, the father, he loved Joseph more than any other children. Of course, he was a rat fake, man. It says he loved him more than any of the other children that had been born to him because Joseph had been born in his old age. You know what that meant? That also meant that Joseph was the baby of the family. You know how that goes, right? Anybody that's here that's the baby of the family? How many of you have a baby brother or sister? Raise your hand if you have a baby brother or sister. What's that like, right? Tell me, right? Especially if you're the middle child. Any middle children in the... Yeah, let's hear it for the middle children! That's what I'm talking about, man, baby brother. Yeah, I give you baby brother. So this is it, right? He's the baby brother. He's the beloved of the father. It says, and Joseph loved him more than the rest of him, and he made for him a special gift, a beautiful coat. Some versions call it a coat of many colors. But his brothers hated him the more because their father loved him. And they couldn't say a kind word about him. You know what I love about, think about this. This is normal. And by normal, I mean crazy. He's got this crazy family going on right here. He's got, when you read the story, he's got a dad who is in the picture, but not in the picture. If you go back and read from Genesis 30, Genesis 37, Jacob, I'll tell you what kind of dad Jacob was. Joseph's father was very passive in his work with the family. As a matter of fact, he just kind of stood back as the father, oversaw the business of the family, and he let whatever happened happen, and he never really got involved. He never spiritually led his family. As a matter of fact, this kid's father, Joseph's father, he was the guy, maybe like you and me at times, that we want God's will, we just want it our way and our time. You know what I'm talking about? And when you try to manipulate God's will, how does that go? When you try to have God's will, God's plan on your terms, man, it does not go well. And what happens is to Joseph's father, Joseph ends up with a mom and three stepmoms. That's what happens. So he's got three stepmothers. He's got 10 stepbrothers. He's got one half-sister and one brother, and they all live in the same house. How awesome is that? I mean, really, the Brady Bunch, we're talking about cousins of Brady. This was the first blended family, not the Bradys, man. I mean, Mike and Carol Brady had nothing on these people. That's what I'm talking about. I mean, can you imagine? Do you know how hard it is? If you do, if you're married here today, men, you know what I'm talking about? How hard it is, how divinely empowered and inspired you need to be to please one wife. Amen, fellas? Amen. Yeah, come on. That's what I'm talking about. I mean, this guy had to please multiple wives. And so this is what happens in the story. You can read it. Every time he pleases one of them, how do you think the other three feel about that? So there's always three women ticked off at this guy. He can't win. That's probably why he's so passive. He's like, give up, man. You know? And all of these dynamics are going on in Joseph's life. And it says here, this happens at the time that he's 17 years old. So he himself, that's an interesting period of his life, right? He's no longer a little boy, but he's not a man. He's still the baby brother. And his father puts him to work and says, oh yeah, your 10 stepbrothers are in charge of you. How joyous was that, right? It was bad enough to work for your brother, never mind your stepbrother, and 10 of them. Well, that was his plight. And he's struggling through all of this with his passive father and his aggressive brothers and the resentment that they feel for him. This is his normal. And what I love about it is that's where God meets him. And this is the guy God uses. That God begins to work in and through Joseph's life. He's just growing up. He's tending the flock. He's kind of a working class guy. That's kind of the family that they have. They're not super, super poor. They're not super, super rich. They're just kind of in the middle class. They're shepherds. That's what they do. And Joseph is learning to work the land. He's learning to lead the sheep. He's working on the farm. He's got all of this stuff going on. And then to top it off, as we read earlier, he's a rat pig. I mean, so I've got all of these dynamics going on, and his spiritual gift becomes telling on all of his brothers. Every time you do something wrong, I'm going to dad, because I want you to love me, right? I mean, who doesn't know that that goes bad every single time? And yet, and dad loves him more. Yeah, how are your brothers doing, man? Just tell me how they're doing today. Just spill it all out there, right? Well, dad, you really haven't been working. It's better, you know, it goes bad for him. He was the favorite son. He was hated. You know what's interesting about this as you read about this family? You know what's missing here? God is missing. As it recounts the history of his life, now God was in there when you read it from Genesis 30 to Genesis 37. But in the daily part of their family life, it seems like faith is absent. This is not the family that they all go to church together and they all got their Bibles and they show up on Easter and they go to Awana and all the kids have their verses memorized. That's not this family. God's not even mentioned in their family. And what I love about that is that's us. And what I really, really love about that is this. All of that stuff, all of that dysfunction, all of that beginnings, all of the junk, all of the hate, all of the anger, all of the resentment, all of the distrust, all of that stuff has little bearing on what God is about to do in this guy's life. And the lesson for you and I is this. And this is why there's hope today. If you this applies to you right now if you're here. Are you here?
Yeah.
Raise your hand if you're here. If you're not here, raise your hand. It's not always normal. It's not always. If you're here and you're breathing, is that you? Good, you sure? Yep, okay, you have a pulse. If you're 3 for 3, man, you're in good shape today. I mean, right? So if that's you, then you can know this. There's nothing in your past. There's nothing in your family. There's nothing that went on so long ago. There's nothing in your life that happened before right now that can keep God from unleashing his plan and his will in your life. Right now, every single one of us can decide, right here, right now, I'm going to be my heart to Jesus Christ. And God, see, here's the real deal. When it comes to the plan of God in your life, your family history, it's not about that. People that are against you, the people that don't like you, the people that resent you, the people that want to cast you out. It's not about that. What you have learned or what you haven't, it's not about that. Here's the reality when it comes to the plan of God. There is only one person on the planet that can keep me from living God's plan for my life. And that's me. The government can't stop me from living God's plan for my life. Truth before God, all the armies of the world could line up against me. But if God before us, who can be against us? There's no excuses. Because if I'm not going to live the plan of God, I'm the only one that's going to stand in the way. Because God's ready. So our past and what we've dealt with before, I love that. Like God puts all of that in this story. As a matter of fact, it says in the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter number 1, it tells us that God often chooses the things that the world doesn't think are anything. It says God doesn't often choose the rich and the wise and the smart and the funny. He doesn't choose those with great talent. As a matter of fact, God chooses things despised by the world. Things, this is what it says. God chooses things that are counted as nothing to bring to pass the things that are. The least, in other words, the least likely person God wants to use. Not the Christian superstar, but the average Joe who will put their faith in God and trust God and begin to walk with God. God will do incredible things in your life. God makes himself known. Here's the spiritual marker. God makes himself known to the humble who will hunger for God. And that's the qualification. And I'm humble before God. Because the Bible says God resists the proud. He gives grace to the humble. Humble yourself before God, and God will exalt you in his time. In due time, in the right place, in the right time, God's going to unleash his plan in your life. And so we see this guy, and we see his past, we see his humble beginning, we see his dysfunctional family. But let's read what happens next, verse number 5. So one night, Joseph had a dream. Now he has this dream, for good or for bad, and he decides to tell his brothers, who all what? They all hate him, they all resent him, and for some reason, Joseph's like, oh, dude, I'm going to go tell my brothers about my dream. And he just goes and does it, that's what he does, right? So it says he has this dream, and for whatever reason, either out of resentment himself, or out of just to get back at him, or out of simplicity, it says he goes to tell his brothers about him, and they hated him more than ever, it says. Listen to the dream. Listen to this dream, he said. We were out in the field, we were tying up bundles of grain, and suddenly, my bundle of grain stood up, and your bundles all bowed down to my bundle. How awesome is that, right? In other words, you're all going to bow down to me. Now you love me even more, don't you? And it says, no, they hated him. He thought that was a good idea, evidently. Crazy, right? I mean, his brothers responded, you think you'll be our king, do you? Do you actually think that you'll reign over? Now listen, if you know the end of the story, be careful about despising someone else's dream, because you never know what. Here's the reality in this. Joseph wasn't God, his brothers weren't God. I'm not God, and you're not God. Lesson number one in the life of Joseph, God is God. God is God, and God is going to prove himself to be God. You think you're going to be our king? Do you actually think you'll reign over us? And again, and they hated him all the more because of his dreams and the way he talked about them. And so if that wasn't enough, read verse 9. Soon Joseph had another dream. And again, he told his brother. Again, this guy is like just a glutton for punishment, right? I mean, he's like, oh man, they'll really get into this dream. They didn't like the last one, so I'm going to give them a new dream. And so he goes and he gives him another dream. Listen to this dream that I had. This time, it's not the bundles of grain. This time it says, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars all bowed down. Basically, the whole universe bowed down to me. How awesome is that? And then he doesn't stop there, it says. He went to tell his father. This time he told the dream to his father as well as his brothers. But even his father scolded him. What kind of dream is that, he asked. Will your mother and brothers and I actually come and bow down before you? But while his brothers were jealous of Joseph, that's something. Here's just a little grain of truth right here. Maybe when I'm despising someone else's dream, I need to check my own motivation. They despised his dream, and God revealed their motivation. They were envious and they were jealous of what was about to happen in his life. And they didn't even know this would happen. So soon after this, the Bible says, Joseph's brothers went to pasture their father's flock at Shechem. And when they had been gone for some time, Jacob said to Joseph, your brothers are pasturing the sheep at Shechem. Get ready, and I will send you to them. And Joseph replied, here it is, I'm ready to go. So go and see how your brothers and flocks are getting along, Jacob said. Then come back and bring me a report. So Jacob sent him away, and Joseph traveled to Shechem from their home in the Valley of Hebron. When he arrived there, a man from the area noticed him wandering around the countryside and said, what are you looking for? I'm looking for my brothers, Joseph replied. Do you know where they are, or where they are pasturing the sheep? Verse 17, yes, the man told him, they have moved on from here, but I heard them say, let us go to Dothan. So Joseph followed his brothers to Dothan and found them there. So this is what's happening now. God's working, and God begins moving. God has a plan that he's going to unleash in this guy's life. But while he's preparing for that plan, while God is yet to give him the specifics and yet to lead him, God's yet to really reveal what all this really means to him, while he's doing that, you know what he's doing? He's just living life. That's what he's doing. As a matter of fact, he's doing the daily stuff. That's what he's doing. Right here it says that he's out tending the father's flocks, he's working in the pasture, he's out working on the farm. And that when his father says, hey, I need you to go to your brothers who hate you, he couldn't resist. You would think it natural. I'm going to those guys. What does he say? I'm ready. You want me to go? I'll go. You know what he does? When you're waiting for God, and as you're growing as a believer, when you're waiting for God to reveal the plan that he has for your life, this is what you do. You do all the things that you should do. It's just that simple. He doesn't try to start. See, his father was a schemer, Jacob. His father always tried to manipulate the plan and work it out his way. That's not when he's got 4 months. That was the problem. I mean, he couldn't wait for God. And it caused him so much grief. It caused so much hurt to so many people. And Joseph, for whatever reasons, decides, you know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to do what I should do. When you don't know, when you're waiting for God to show you his plan, this is what you do as a Christian. While you're waiting for God to show you the specific plan, you walk in light of what God has already said. That's what you do. You walk in the light of what God has already said. I'm just going to steal this. I'm not going to steal it. I'm really not.
It's a Bible for the church. I won't steal it.
If you want to know what God has already said, you read this. So what do I do while I'm waiting for God to show? I do whatever the Bible says. That means I give and I pray and I serve and I worship. I go to work every day. I pay my bills. I do the things that the Bible tells me that I should do. When people wrong me, I pray for them and I forgive them. I give of my offerings to God. I give of my time to God. I serve in the ministry for God. I just do all of the things while I'm waiting for God to show me the specifics of the plan. I walk in light of what God has already said, and this is what God has already said. There's so many Christians that are waiting for God to show them the plan, but they don't want to do this. If you don't want to do this, what is the likelihood that God's going to show you the details of the plan for your life? God says, you don't want to do what I already told you to do. Why would I give you more? I begin when it gets daily, and that's what life is. That's what often the Bible doesn't want, the mountaintop experiences. But there's days and weeks and years in this story where Joseph is just doing the daily stuff that he's supposed to do. And as he's doing that, you can know this. When you're going through the daily grind, you can know that God is working. You can know that God is preparing your heart, that God is changing your life, that God is working. When you don't see it, that's a truth that we see from this story over and over and over and over again, that God is moving when I don't see it, because nothing is ever out of God's control. Nothing is ever outside of who God is. And so let's look what happens. So then things kind of take a turn. It says there, let's look at, what was that, verse number 12. He goes down, I don't have my Bible, so I got to scroll down here. It says, there we go. Thank you. Verse 18. That's where we left off. When Joseph's brothers saw him coming, they recognized him at a distance. And as he approached, they made plans to kill him. How awesome is that, right? These guys are really upping the game right now. I mean, they're taking it to another level. That's what they're doing right there. You ever hear a whole nother level? Well, they're taking it to a whole nother level right here. They're not just going to talk about taunting him, and they're going to kill him. Here comes the dreamer, they said. Come on, let's kill him and throw him into one of these cisterns, into this well. We'll tell our father a wild animal has come and eaten him. Then we'll see what becomes of his dreams. There's a little bit of bitterness maybe in their heart. But then he's got a savior, amen? He's got this brother named Reuben. But when Reuben heard of their scheme, he came to Joseph's rescue. Awesome! Let's not kill him, he said. Why should we shed any blood? Let's just throw him into this empty well here in the wilderness. Then he'll die without our laying hands on him. How awesome is that, right? In other words, we can kill him and not really kill him. This would be great. It's better for everybody. But it doesn't end. That's not really what he had planned. So it says, we'll throw him, he'll die without us laying a hand on him. But Reuben, he had this guy that was for him. Reuben was secretly planning to rescue Joseph and return him to the father. So when Joseph arrived, his brothers ripped off the robe. They start donning. I don't think they were gentle about this. They ripped off the robe. They grabbed him and they threw him into the pit, into the cistern. Now the cistern was empty. There was no water in it. Then, just as they were sitting down to eat, so here they are, they're having dinner, he's down in the hole in the ground, they looked up and they saw a caravan of camels in the distance coming toward them. It was a group of Ishmaelite traders taking a load of gum and balm and aromatic resin from Gilead down to Egypt. Judah, who was one of the brothers, Judah said to his brothers, "What will we gain by killing him? Hey, I got an idea, man. We'd have to cover up the crime. And instead of hurting him, let's sell him to these Ishmaelite traders. After all, he's our brother, our own flesh and blood." And his other brothers agreed. So this guy comes up with a whole new idea. Let's not kill him. Let's just sell him as a slave. How awesome is that, right? This totally takes me back to my own sons. I remember when my son Matt is sitting here right now. My son Matt was 4 years old, and we had a little brother, you know? And one day, little brother Jacob was in the crib, and my wife came in the room, and Matthew's just standing there looking at him, staring at him. You know, he's holding on to the crib, looking in. And she's got this proud mama moment going on, Mary does, you know? And she's like, "Matt, that's your little brother. What do you think of that?" And at the time, we had some neighbors that lived upstairs to us, Carmelo and Annette Torres. He's a pastor over in Holyoke. And so she says, what do you think of that? And he says, "Can't we just give him to Annette? I mean, let's sell him, Mary. Let's sell him. That was it, you know?" So there's nothing new under the sun. That's what we learn here. So brothers still getting rid of their brothers. That's why I've got middle brother syndrome. This thing takes a turn. And they sell him, as a matter of fact. As a matter of fact, if you look down with me at verse number 36, and it says, while they arrived in Egypt, they sold Joseph to Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. Potiphar was a captain in the palace of the king. He's the leader. And the thing about Egyptians is, you know who they really, really hate of all people? They hate shepherds. And guess what Joseph is? He's a shepherd. So now he's sold to these Ishmaelites, who then sell him to these Egyptians. And by the way, for what his brothers thought of him, the Bible says here that they sold him for 20 pieces of silver. 30 pieces of silver was the price of a common slave. His brothers didn't even think that much of it. "We'll give you a bargain on this guy. He's not even as good as a regular slave. We'll sell him to you for 20 pieces of silver." And now he's in the work and the captive of Potiphar. And he's not going to be there for a few days or a few weeks or a few months. He's going to be there for over 2 decades. And there's going to be times when he's in the prison, when he's falsely accused, when heaven is absolutely silent. There's going to be times where God, he's praying out, he's crying out to God, and he continues to do the right thing. Have you ever done this? You do the right thing, and sometimes it seems like the more right that you do, the more wrong happens to you. You ever been there? How do I deal with that? What do I do? What do I do while I'm waiting and I'm crying out to God? Because there was a time where Joseph was, he was waiting for God, and he was serving, and he was doing what he knew to do. And now, to be honest with you, he's in a place where that's all he can do. He's in prison now. He can't, you know what sometimes we do when we're waiting for God? We're not always good waiters. We don't value that. What we like is we want to see things happen, man. I want to be moving forward. I want to be where the action is. I want to know that God is working on my behalf. And I want to be able to see it with my eyes. I want to be able to feel it and experience it. The reality is there's times in your Christianity where God's just going to say, "I just want you to wait right here. I just want you to wait. I don't want you to run." We're really good at running. Things don't go our way, we run. I run from my job, I run from my family. I run, if I'm not careful, I can run from God, I can run from my church. I'll run, if I just lived in Florida, man, everything would be good. Everything is good in Florida, man. Mickey Mouse lives there, how bad can it be, right? I mean, so we see that, I'm telling you. I remember not too long ago, a couple came to me, "We're moving to Hawaii, Pastor Kevin. Nothing's going right here. Moving to Hawaii." 6 months later, they came back, and the money was gone, their house was gone.
Because we take us with us. That's the problem. If I really need to take a vacation, I just need to take a vacation from me, not from everyone else. That's the reality. And if we're not careful, we run. But sometimes, like Joseph right here, God puts him in the place where he can't run, and all he can do is wait. And when I've been sold to Potiphar, what do? I've got to remember that God is still God. That's what I've got to remember. I've got to remember that nothing is ever out of God's control. He's working when I can't see it. I've got to remember this. When I don't see it and don't feel it, God is good. All the time, God is good. God is good. And God is working for my best interest when my eyes, when my ears, and when my feelings tell me something other than that. The Bible says that all things work together for what? Good. To those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose, Romans 8:28. God is working in advance for my good. But this is what's happening. While I'm waiting, you see, the reality is we also value in our society and in our culture, we value comfort. Comfort is not comfort, worldly comfort in this life. Spiritual comfort from God, that's biblical. Being comfortable in life, that's not a biblical value. As a matter of fact, Jesus told his disciples, you're going to have comfort that comes from outside of this world, and it's going to work inside of you, but you're not going to have comfort on the outside of you while you're in this world. As a matter of fact, it's going to be perilous and dangerous. But we value comfort, and sometimes we spiritualize it. God is so much more concerned about your character than your comfort. See, we want to know about the will of God. We want to know, what should I do, what should I do, what should I do, what should I do? And I know I've talked about this many times, but I come back to it again and again. God is not so concerned about what he wants you to do. God is really concerned about who he wants you to be. That's what's happening on the inside of here. Because here's the reality. If I don't become who God wants me to be, I'll never be equipped to do what he wants me to do. I want to know what he wants me to do, and God says, we've got to slow down, Jeff. Because before you can do what I've called you to do, I've got to equip you with who I want you to be, who I want you to be, working on the inside. That's what's happening right now in Joseph's life. He's sold as a slave. God's working in his life. You know what I love about this? The Hebrew name Joseph, you know what that means? Amazing. There is nothing coincidental about the Bible. The Hebrew name Joseph, it means addition. It means to add. It means to increase. Literally, it means this: something more. He was something more. In the whole world, thought he was nothing. When his brothers didn't want him and they sold him, when the Egyptians looked upon him and saw that he's just a common slave, when everyone thought he was nothing, God looked at him and said, no, he's something more. I'm going to do incredible things through this guy's life. I've got a story that's about to unfold in this guy's life. That's not just Joseph. That's you. This story, you're Joseph. That's who you are. It's the story of just ordinary people with common struggles and the ups and downs. Often people, if we're not careful, we can just feel like we're nothing. But an extraordinary God who looks at your life and says, I not only want to make you something more, I want you to know that you're valued as something more. So much so that I was willing to send my own son to die in your place so that you could have life. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for this time to be in your house this morning, Lord God, a time to worship in Jesus Christ. God, I thank you that you took this 17-year-old that was despised and hated and had all of his ups and downs, Lord God, and that you wanted to do something more. That you saw something more in his life, Jesus. I'm so grateful today, Lord God, for looking down. The Bible says again, the eyes of the Lord look to and fro throughout the whole earth. And I believe with all of my heart, God's looking today, right now, at every one of us. It's not that you have to be something more on your own. You can't. But Jesus Christ thought you were something more. So much so, he paid the price for your redemption. He died for you. He did for you what you could never do. See, here's the reality. All the gold and all the diamonds and all of the dollars that could be amassed in one great treasure could not pay for your redemption. But Jesus Christ paid that price with his own blood. God was going to accomplish his plan, and he didn't need Joseph to do it. But he wanted Joseph. And God looks at us today, and he doesn't need me. He doesn't need you. But he wants you. So much so, he died for you. And he says here today, I'm looking for someone who will get real with God. You see, that's what God knows. I can fool other people, I can even fool myself, but I'm never fooling God, never one second. He looks right through you. He looks right to your heart of hearts. And he says to you today, would you just say, Jesus Christ, I want to trust you, Lord God. Jesus, if I'm honest with myself, I don't even understand what that completely means, to be given to God, to totally trust you, to have a heart that's perfect towards you. But Lord God, that's what I want, if that's what you want. That's what yieldedness is all about. Would you say that to God this morning? I'm going to stop wrestling with you, Lord Jesus, to try to get your will my way. And I just want your plan for my life. And if that means right now I wait, then I want to wait for your glory. If that means right now that I worship and serve, that I give, that I love, that I read and study and pray, if that means there's someone I need to forgive, then I'm going to walk in light of what you've already said. I'm going to forgive. I'm going to show grace as you have shown to me, Jesus. I'm going to show compassion to the people around me. I'm going to love as you have loved. That's what I'm going to do, Lord God. Because I don't want to get ahead. Lord Jesus, have your plan in my life. Have your way in my heart. That's every part of me. Listen, all of that begins with a relationship with Jesus Christ. I want to be very, very clear. We don't go to heaven because we're good people, because we try hard. No one's ever getting to heaven because they joined LifePoint Church or any other church. It's not about what you have done. It's about what Jesus did for you, and that was he died on the cross. But you need to receive him, have you? You need to receive Jesus Christ. Be very, very clear. It's not enough for you to know about Jesus. You must receive him by faith, the Bible says. For with the heart, man believes to righteousness. With the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. For anyone that calls upon him shall be saved. It's a matter of faith. For by grace are you saved through faith. And that's a personal decision. And so I'm asking you right here, right now, have you received Jesus Christ as your Savior? If you have, you'll know it. Because it'll begin to show. In your heart, in your life, in your attitudes, God begins to move. And if you've never done that, my prayer for you is right here, right now, you begin a relationship with Jesus. Right here today. So how do I do that, Pastor Kevin? Between you and God, right where you sit, you just need to whisper a prayer. Jesus Christ, I confess I need you. I believe you're the one. Save me. That's it. It's that simple. I need you, Jesus. I believe that you are the one, that you are the Savior. I need you. Save me. Come into my life. Make me your child. The Bible says that anyone that calls upon him shall be saved. When you call out and ask him to save you, he says yes forever and ever and ever. And then the work begins. God moving in your life, strengthening, growing, challenging, walking with you every day, because he wants to unleash the plans of an extraordinary God in an ordinary life. Father, thank you for this time again today. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you would be glorified. Thank you for the time that we could spend in your word this morning. God, I pray that you'd help us to take it with us today, not just to leave it here when we go out, but to bring you honor and bring you glory. I ask your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Thank you guys so much for joining us today. If you've accepted this grace, this free gift of salvation, we are so excited for you, and we would love it if you told someone that you came with. But take a minute and grab that same communication card and see back in front of you. Flip it over. It's our Life Path section. Fill it out. You can bring it to the Welcome Center. We have a Bible for you, and we just want to just come alongside you in this journey of just discovering all that Jesus has for us. And through this discovery, God just brings to light, man, his grace and his love. And we talked at the beginning of the service about our life discovery classes. This is just finding out, man, what God has for us. As Pastor said, we're normal people, but we serve an extraordinary God. And his plan and his purpose is amazing, beyond even what we can comprehend. If you're interested in learning more about that, take a minute and fill out that yellow card, drop it in the black box. Let's see all that God has for us. I hope that this message, we don't just keep it to ourselves, this hope that we have. Let's tell someone else about it. Let's get in the Word, as Pastor said, and let's invite someone to come back next week and hear about this message of love and grace. I hope that you guys have a great week. God bless. You are dismissed.